Ja, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, einen
right, ladies and gentlemen,
guten Morgen.
A wonderful good morning to you. I hope it is a good morning for all of you after what must have been a merry Thursday evening, which is a natural part of our trade show in any case. We are very happy to see you here on the second floor of the trade show building to welcome you to a very interesting morning that is all about theory and practice and national as well as international aspects. We've put together four very interesting and entertaining papers for you, and I invite you to participate actively. We will keep your questions for the end of the session so that the speakers can answer them jointly. Let me point out another highlight of our morning session. A summary of our meeting here will be presented to you not by myself, but by our well-known comedian and musician, Markus Linder, who is hiding in the audience, which is quite difficult for him because he is a very tall person. So he will give us a musical summary of the proceedings. But I don't want to keep you from our speakers any longer because I'm sure you've come here to listen to them, not to me. Let me introduce the expert in tourism of Tyrol, our expert from MCI, the Management Center Innsbruck. Hubert, the floor is yours. Professor Hubert Siller. Thank you, dear Bruno, and a wonderful good morning to you, also from my side. Theory, practice, and whatever else. Well, I try to link the two always, but good theory has never done any harm to good practice. Today, I would like to present to you a strategic logic of success using our attitudes and mindset to tourism. As an example, we educate many young people at MCI Innsbruck, and ultimately, it's all about structured and entrepreneurial-minded thinking. And this is the basis we evolved our logic on. I will try to give you an overview of tourism in the Alpine space within the framework of the Interalpin trade show, which is back. Thankfully. So, some facts and figures on tourism in the Alpine space, and afterwards, a few words about our strategic logic of success. Well, you are all familiar with the Alpine space and the countries it comprises. Austria is located quite in the middle. The Alpine space is small, safe, cool, and rich. These are the adjectives that describe it very well. Now, looking at the world as such, the Alpine space is certainly quite small with rugged mountains and people that take some getting used to, but that are entirely reliable and have handshake qualities. So, the Alpine space is small. It is also safe, although want to be careful about using this world. We have alpine safety in our mountains, which is certainly one of our strengths. The alpine space is cool. It is located at a certain altitude, which will be decisive for the development of tourism over the next few decades. This will bring many more advantages than challenges, so although currently it is the challenges that are the focus of the attention. In future, this attribute will bring us many advantages both in summer and in winter. And the Alpine space is rich, it is prosperous. It is one of the most prosperous regions of the world, excepting some big cities where people live only temporarily. similar to New York. While the Alpine space as a place to live in can be preserved only because there is tourism there. Well, the Alpine space in total has about 500 million overnight stays. These are pre-COVID figures, but we are almost back to pre-COVID levels. About half of these overnight stays are commercial stays, and the other half is non-commercial. Second homes, for example, are a big issue in the Alpine space, a very big issue even in some areas, with the emphasis on real estate business. And the danger for the Alpine space here is that these beds are lukewarm, sometimes they are cold, and sometimes they are frozen even. Their capacity utilization of these holiday homes or second homes is not good, which means that regional local infrastructure is lost. So 43% of all overnight stays are in winter. We've heard yesterday from Mr. Santander that 96% of all global destinations have only one season. The Alpine area has two seasons to rely on, and this is a huge privilege because it makes all year tourism possible. 7.5 million beds, every sixth of these is a hotel bed, lots of small scale accommodation facilities like private rentals, pensions, bed and breakfasts. And from the EU28 perspective, and I do know that the UK is no longer part of the European Union, but this figure here includes the UK. The Alpine space accounts for 14.4% of all commercial overnight stays in the European Union. Now, tourism in the Alpine space in general, the Alpine region, generates about 45% of all skier days worldwide, 158 million skier days in the Alps. Now, the future of skier days, from our perspective, is not challenged. There will be a certain transformation into alternative winter resorts away from skiing and towards other forms of winter sports. But due to its geographical location alone, other winter sports are possible beyond skiing. I will not mention any more figures now because we don't have the time here. Now, this slide here shows you the seasonal breakdown in the Alps region, the breakdown between summer and winter. In Tyrol, right at the bottom of this list, we find that winter tourism is 50% in the Tyrol, closely followed by Salzburg, Vorarlberg, the Swiss cantons of Grisons and Valois. And here another slide, giving you the source markets of vacationers in the Alps. We have Switzerland here that has a very strong domestic market. Domestic markets are essential. Tyrol has a rather weak domestic market. It is right at the bottom of this chart. This means that we are very international with Germany, the Netherlands, the Benelux countries in general as our big source markets. The carbon footprint of tourism is, of course, a big issue also at our university, the Management Center Innsbruck. Sustainability keeps coming up. I'd rather call it responsible tourism development. What does responsible mean? That we assume responsibility for the people, the planet, but ultimately also for the profit we make in order to keep this economic cycle going. Now, let's look at the figures one by one. Of course, the outbound and inbound journeys cause the biggest carbon footprint, followed by accommodation and food. Of course, we generate the lowest footprint if we stay at home, but this is not our purpose here. So the biggest contributors to the carbon footprint are the journey to and from the destination, accommodation, food, and on-site activities. In the Tyrol, 86% of our tourists travel to our destination by car. In my opinion, this carbon footprint is going to improve in the immediate future. There shouldn't be any blaming for people who don't travel to the Tyrol by electric vehicle only. We don't want to make this differentiation here. But I think this carbon footprint will diminish, will get smaller in future. Let me now move on to our strategic logic of success for the Alpine space in particular. This is a model that we also explain to our young people, and the logic is quite simple. Why is this important? Because we often begin on the wrong end when we talk about success in tourism. And this is why we've established this logic of success that puts the problem first, followed by the competence with which the problem is solved, followed by the product and the marketing. Normally, product comes first, followed by communication. So our approach is slightly different in this regard. I do a lot of research in this field. It was a Swiss businessman who said, there's nothing more strategic than identifying the customer problem. What kind of problem of the customer are we trying to solve? If somebody studies economics, the problem is not that he can do cash flow calculations, but we need this student to get an overall understanding of economics. So we are very specific in our approach. We put the customer problem first, and we want to identify the customer problem. Let me quote Magnus Enzensberger, who once said, tourists are trying to escape the realities they have themselves created. So this escape element is a key element of tourism, of traveling. 10 years later, Heuwinkel said that the impulse to leave the daily routine behind is a key element of tourism. Yes, we want to leave it all behind. We want to get out of the everyday grind and enter alternative worlds. And this picture here symbolizes this very well. Or this one here. These are pictures that stay in your mind. Everybody wants to go to these destinations, so we need to manage tourism flows. 120 million Chinese are getting ready to travel, and we'll have to cope with this. But this image symbolizes what I'm saying very well as well. This mountain picture. Of course, deck chairs and beaches don't always look as beautiful as I've just shown you. But this pictures of this kind cause desires for alternative worlds. Marketing alone is not enough, however. Another quote, we must add happiness, fun, curiosity, and the fascination for travel and foreign cultures to tourism as a means of escaping the daily grind. It is not just your long-distance flights that reflects the fascination of travel. It's also a car trip from Hamburg with the whole family. And once you get to your destination, you want to be able to experience something really special. You want to enter this alternative world. Let me quote myself. The future of tourism is about the search for resonant moments that touch us deeply. Happiness is an important element of it all. Happiness researchers also say that happiness is not a permanent condition. Happiness is all about moments that touch us deeply and that we keep in mind. In other words, we are becoming hunters of the moments, small moments, not necessarily big moments. Why am I telling you this? Because it's all about solving problems. We must get the details right. Monumental structures won't help us at all if we don't get the moments right. It is all about resonant moments. This is our claim. Resonant moments are for all kinds of different things, and the acid of snow is the acid to create these resonant moments. I go skiing a lot myself, and if you look at the other skiers, you will see many happy faces, many people experiencing exactly these moments of resonance.
Experience seekers. We are moment hunters. We are freedom finders. For us, the mountains are most magnetic. We throw ourselves at their feet, stand on their rooftops, and carve from the moments that, when collected, define who we are. These moments live here. Welcome to Whistler.
Habe bewusst einen Spot aus Nordamerika aufgegriffen.
I deliberately used this video clip from North America because it's not only about this big Whistler resort, but about the moments you can experience there. And this is the solution to the problem. These two companies here also solve customer problems. Nobody drinks Red Bull because it tastes so nice. Red Bull is about solving an entirely different kind of problem. Or Netflix. Netflix has generated a huge transformation in television. If Netflix didn't exist, our public TV stations would be light years behind where they are now. Or these two examples, a clear solution to a problem, rent happiness. Rent Happiness found out at some point that ski instructors needed to literally carry little kids around for 6 hours a day. So they developed conveyor systems, conveyor belts, that have been around for decades. This is a solution to a genuine problem. So you always want to ask yourself the question, what kind of problem am I trying to solve? Rent Happiness was the message of a big trading company, a ski rental company. This provider here, 4 years ago, Melanie Kindl, had an excellent idea to solve the problem of scratched goggles. I like the mindset behind this. I mean, the first scratch in your new goggles really hurts, not so much the second or the third, but the first one. So they invented this protection here. Let's move on to competence, point two, after identifying the problem. What you want is to lead in terms of experience and knowledge. And this competence is very pronounced in the Alpine area. There are many companies, like many resorts like this one here, Serfaus Fisladis, is leading in competence with their slogan, "We are family." It's not just about marketing, it's about the tiniest little details, and that is how they have acquired leadership in terms of competence. I'm also part of the Tyrolean Tourism Development Authority, and Tyrol sees itself as a leader in competence and innovation in winter sports, which involves many different aspects and topics. Or this company here, an exhibitor at the Interalpine, two floors down, they have a passion for snowmaking. And without this passion, winter sports wouldn't work and wouldn't be able to solve the problem and to create or contribute to so many resonant moments. I entered the ski instructor business in the mid-80s, and I can say that everything was a lot more difficult back then. Getting the clients to the slopes was difficult because we didn't have the kind of ropeway infrastructure we have now. In attempting to solve problems in tourism, we need to look beyond our own garden fence. The airline industry, for example, is getting a lot of the details right. Singapore Airlines, for example, they have their flight attendants that walk up and down the aisles all the time. Their message is not, we are the biggest airlines with the highest number of planes. Their message is, we get all the details right, and we create ambience, we create atmosphere. And this video illustrates my point.
Warum der Film?
Why am I showing you this video clip? To point out that the details are important. So they have their uniform dress, the flight attendants. Even the length of their fingernails is regulated. Every little detail is taken care of. Many have tried to copy this approach, but not all of them have been successful. And I'm not referring to Austrian Airlines in any way here. Now, my third point, the product. So we've started with the problem, moved on to competence, and are talking about the product now. Normally, those will be most successful who understand the problem, have the competence to solve it, and develop the right kind of product. The product is about innovation and experience, about designing the experience, orchestrating the experience, just like Singapore Airlines does. And nothing is left to chance there. Now, I have a very simple message for you. Convenience always wins. In many innovations in the Alpine area, in the ropeway industry, the question is often asked, does my product make things more convenient? Does it solve a problem? Is it a benefit for the customer? If you can't answer these questions in the affirmative, you should think twice about going ahead. Everything that increases convenience will be successful in the market. We can talk about digitalization all day. If digitalization increases convenience, the product will be successful, and will be successful fast. There's any number of examples of this. Two big manufacturers represented at this exhibition too. Their innovation have been successful because they enhanced convenience with automatic restraining bars, six-seated chairs, bubbles, seat heating, child safety lock in every seat and so on. So they understood the problem, they tackled the problem, had the competence to solve it. Einstein once said, what is conceivable is also feasible. And that is absolutely true. Now, talking about product development, let me tell you that design is attitude, and the mindset is changing now. Some innovators are doing this more than others, but design is attitude. The design, the architecture, makes products and mountains speak for themselves. So this is a mandate for all service providers or product providers. This is what a mountain terminal can look like with a very crisp, reduced architectural approach. This is in Lax, by the way. I could give you any number of examples to illustrate my point, but our destination partner at MCI is Schladming-Dachstein. This is another successful example of good design. And the next speaker will be a very important representative of this mindset. Design is attitude. Design doesn't have to be shrill or colorful or include 56 different logos, which is what happens in some places. I think the use of materials is also very important because they should match the mountain you are trying to market. If you give me another couple of minutes, let me move on to marketing. Now, once we got the problem and the competence, the product right, we can move on to marketing. But only once we got all this right can we move on to marketing. Marketing is about desires and about name recognition. Name recognition alone won't help us, but is essential for this approach to be successful, because name recognition must be linked to desires. John Jansch once said, marketing is getting people to know, like, and trust you. You must know people, you must like them, and you should trust them. This is essential. If people don't trust you, this won't help you at all. Quite on the contrary. Now, how does this tie in with your destination? What is your destination like, my destination like? How popular is it? And so on. I mentioned fun earlier in my presentation. And it is about getting this message of fun across. And many resorts are doing this very well, because the guest, the customer, the tourist is our biggest commercial. It's not just word by mouth propaganda that counts, but it is also important. We want our guests to tell others how much they enjoyed their stay in our resorts. Now, how Instagrammable is our destination, is your destination? This is also an important question. Are you familiar with this resort? Do you know it? Well, not all of you will be, but you will know it now. So this resort is very lucky to have this characteristic mountain, this summit here. And of course, it is part of it all. We have assets in our destination that are typical, that are characteristic, that are unique, and this should be marketed too. Now, another message that I don't want to go into, I will not run this video clip that had 3.4 billion clicks since 2017, a clip made by Ed Sheeran. Please do click this link, this page. It is a journey through a skiing day, a journey videotaped by a young person. I will show you after all. because the video tells you more than 1,000 words.
Wird im Zillertal gedreht.
The location is the Zillertal Valley. The road had to be closed for the production.
Darling, just dive right in. Follow my lead. Well, I found a girl, beautiful and sweet. Well, I never knew you were the someone waiting for me. 'Cause we were just kids when we fell in love, not knowing what it was. I will not give you up this time. Darling, just kiss me slow. Your heart is all I own. And in your eyes, you're holding mine. Baby, I'm dancing in the dark with you between my arms, barefoot on the grass, listening to our favorite song. When you said you looked a mess, I whispered underneath my breath, but you heard it. Darling, you look perfect tonight. Well, I found a woman stronger than anyone I know.
So, as I take these notes.
Well, there's another 2.5 minutes to go, but let me stop here. Well, this message of how many problems are solved, your theme, the motivation behind it, are demonstrated really well by this video clip and 1.3 billion clips not to be ignored. So I've tried to give you my logic, strategic logic of success. Success in alpine tourism is not a coincidence. This is my last message before I hand over to the next speaker or to our moderator. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this insight into the business. Now, our next speaker, I don't think I have to introduce or present him to you. It's like carrying coals to Newcastle. He has done a lot for Sölden and for the entire Ötztal Valley, but he is going to tell you more about this. I'm going to give him a chair because Jack is suffering from some back pain. He has just had a surgery, so therefore I will provide a chair for him or a stool. And so, Jack, the floor is yours. Yes, thank you, and grüß Gott. I think I'm very lucky because the professor who spoke before me told us what we have to do, and I can tell you how we can implement that. We work together in a working group called Future Mountains. So there we have this theoretical input from the professor, and we have been working together for a long time. I've been listening carefully about when this strategy was presented. With regard to the video, I would say it's a very emotional video, but I actually did not see how any problems were solved. But it's a great video. Now, about Sölden, about our resort, we have three operators there, but we cooperate so that the customers are not even aware of that. We are the main service provider in our community, and we try to be a modern service provider. For those of you who don't know Sölden, we are not the biggest resort, we are not the best resort, but we are a very nice resort, and we have many advantages in winter. We have a lot of snow. We can guarantee snow because we have mountains higher than 3,000 meters, and we even have a glacier going up to 3,250 meters. So we have always tried to find our own way to do it our way. For instance, we have set up scenic platforms, and we did that a long time ago, and after that we were copied by many other resorts. And to talk about the snow covering, we have this advantage of having two glaciers. And some 25 years ago, we connected the winter skiing area with the two glaciers. Before, you had to take the road to go up to the glacier, and when there was too much snow or avalanches, this was difficult. Now we can use ropeways to get there to the glacier. So we also have the biggest downhill slope in Austria with a 15 kilometers length, and we have the biggest difference in altitude of almost 2,000 meters. That is the biggest difference here. We have what we call the big three. This is something very special. It was marketing, and it is a result of our working group on the future. And there was a representative of Disneyland in Los Angeles who described the feeling he had when he entered the valley, and he told us we have to stage things in a more professional way. So Professor Schuck had the idea that we could use the three mountains higher than 3,000 meters to set up those panorama platforms. On the left-hand side, you see this tower, this obelisk, and then you see the top station at the Tiefenbach and the Geisserkogel, where we have also this platform. So three mountains higher than 3,000 meters, and we have three platforms. It's important to take time and inhale the scenic view and to enjoy this view. So those platforms are ideal for that, and they've been a great marketing tool for us over many years. For me, the number of kilometers is not so important. I keep repeating that. What counts for me is the area per skier. And here we have a fantastic value in Sölden. Also, entertainment is important, restaurants, mountain huts. And it has been mentioned we also need parking. So far, we have free parking, even though we may have to change that in future, because the parking is also needed for our staff and for local people. So we will have to charge tourists in future. Then it's also important to have ski depots and ski rental facilities. That's very convenient, and convenience is important. We have two very powerful feeder ropeways from the village of Sölden going up to the mountain. Increasing the capacity does not always mean that you transport more people. That's not always the case, but increasing the capacity can also mean that you can take up passengers to the mountain right from the early morning. This is also convenience for the passengers. So we have a very powerful feeder ropeway in terms of convenience. I'm not going to talk much about the history of our ropeways, but there have been many developments in the past, and things change quickly. So we developed 6 new ropeways within a few years' time. This is the new ropeway, which was opened in 2010 with the bottom station. It's like an envelope, which is very thin, like a thin skin. And there were doubts that this would resist against wind load, but it did. And why did we choose this solution? Well, we didn't want to have a concrete building at the village. We wanted to respect nature, and we wanted to enable people to see nature. And so architecture and design are very important, and we have always paid a lot of attention to that. Now, here you can see the Geislach-Kogel ropeway. The costs were 36 million euros at the time, probably. This would cost twice as much now. We also have another facility. We created the James Bond element, which I'm going to tell you more about later on. So this is really a unique combination that you will never find anywhere else in the Alps, with a modern ropeway, a modern restaurant, and James Bond. Here you can see some pictures of the bottom and top stations. Now, again, this is the Gigijoch ropeway, and I'm not going to talk much about the history, but there have been 3 different editions of this ropeway over a time. And you can see the different solutions. And this is the most recent ropeway. You can also see the scenic view. It's beautiful at night when everything is lit. So this new bottom station is half as big as the old one. So it's a much better solution. So this is an advantage because then we needed less land, and we have a capacity of 4,500 persons per hour. Mike Doppelmeier is part of our working group on the future, and this is very helpful for us, of course, to have somebody like him in the working group, because it makes things easier and a lot of things can be solved by handshake. Now, here are some number games. 6.5 meters per second is the speed. It takes less than 10 minutes to get up to the mountains. And I think that this envelope that we have also used here for the top station provides this transparency. I actually wanted to say a few words about marketing. When the gondola reach the top, they move around the roof. I think it would be nice to have some dancers below that roof and to produce a video below those moving gondolas and cabins with some dancers. So here you can see some information about our transport capacity. As I said, we are not the biggest ones, but we are very powerful, and we have those benefits like a good snow coverage and the big difference in altitude, so long slopes. And snowmaking, restaurants, things like that, that's the basics, really. This has to be there. This has to work. Of course, the passengers will notice if there is a modern ropeway or not. But you have to differentiate yourself. And in order to do that, we have built this restaurant Ice Q, which is where we have the James Bond event. So the producers of that event saw the restaurant on the internet, and then they talked to us. In the movie, this is actually a hospital, but in reality, this scene was produced in the Ice Cube restaurant. So James Bond came to Sölden, and we were told that our logistics were perfect. We had the possibilities to provide easy access. We even had a small airport in the neighboring village so that the plane could reach Sölden, the plane needed for the James Bond movie. But I'll tell you more about that later on. Then we also have another modern restaurant, which is the Falcon. Of course, we also have traditional mountain huts as well. But we have those modern restaurants, which many customers like. Some customers prefer traditional mountain huts, and we do have them as well. But we wanted to have those modern facilities on the Geislach Kogel. When you talk about innovation, you have to understand that tourism is always very emotional, and traveling is normally the best time people experience during the year, and we can work on many different things. We can work on architecture, on design, on technology. We can work on our service offers. We can work on pricing. All of this is innovation in a way. All of this can provide some additional benefit to the customers. And as a company, we can only be successful if we make money. So our business is simple. We have to make money and invest. Speed of the development is increasing. The cycles have become much shorter nowadays. So you have to earn more money and invest more. And this kind of investment and development can also be a challenge. But it is necessary for the convenience of our customer, and because we want to improve our offerings. And if we want to survive on the market, this kind of investment is absolutely inevitable. Snowmaking is also very important for our resorts. We have a big storage lake. We worked together with the environmental protection authorities. So they told us, don't build three or four such storage lakes, just build one big one. And that's what we did. And two-thirds of our slopes are covered, can be covered with artificial snow. This is one of the main prerequisites, of course. And then another important aspect in this business is pricing. And pricing can help us to improve our business case. We have to be profitable. And so we used this dynamic pricing, which is not really something new, but we were the first big skiing resort who applied such a dynamic pricing system. During the pandemic, it was difficult, but now this works very well, and it has helped us a lot, this dynamic pricing system. So what is our positioning? We stand for sports, but we also stand for entertainment. And this is our claim, and this is what we also implement every day. So it's not just about the major events that I'm going to tell you more about in a minute. It's also about everyday skiing and après-skiing. So we offer different options every day for our guests. So I think this kind of positioning is crucial, and you have to really then implement it in a coherent way. Ah, now something went wrong here. Ah, very good. We also have World Cup race. So we have been fighting for it for years. And our advantage is that we are the first ones who can show snow on TV early in the season. And again, emotions are very important. I still remember in Germany on TV, soccer is always very important. Bayern München is very important. And there was a goal, but you could hardly see it because there was so much fog. And then all of a sudden there was a cut and you could see the blue sky and the snow on TV. And that was really a game changer. And we can be the first ones in the season to show snow. And this will then be seen in the entire world. So this is why we were able to organize this Ski World Cup. Last week we had the Electronic Mountain event. We have extended it to 2 days. We invited many stars and we attracted a lot of young audience. Another highlight for me, that's Hannibal. We stage Hannibal every 2 years. It starts in the early morning. In twilight. It's a great performance, a great show, and it shows Hannibal and the Carthaginians. We need a lot of support for that. We need a helicopter. We need athletes who come down from the sky. Red Bull is our sponsor there. So it's a very interesting plot. And so we actually stage the story of Hannibal on our glacier. And both the Electronic Mountain Festival and the Hannibal show attract about, let's say, a maximum of 10,000 people. For the FIS World Cup, we have up to 22,000 visitors per day, but that's the biggest event, and we can handle that. Now, these are some beautiful pictures for all those of you who have never seen Hannibal. I can invite you to come and see us next year. We had problems last time because of the pandemic, and we still organized this event. And some people were afraid that this is not a good time to stage this during times of war in Ukraine, but we staged it, and nobody had this association and thought about the war in Ukraine. So the event was a real success. Beforehand, there was a lot of criticism, as I said, in the press, but afterwards, the visitors were happy and the press didn't talk about us anymore or about the event. So these are pictures of this Hannibal show. We wanted to work with a real elephant, but then there was protest because of animal welfare aspects, so we did not use a real elephant in the end.
Das war in jetzt doch eine relativ lange Zeit, die das Unternehmen.
So, this has been a real highlight in my career. It's been a very interesting time, the time when this movie was produced. The ice cube that I mentioned beforehand was chosen as a venue, and we were able to provide very good logistical solutions. And in 2015, the team, the movie team, came for 15 days. There was a first unit, that's the original actors, Daniel Craig, Lea Seydoux, and then there was the second unit, that's the stuntmen, which I found even more interesting, and they came in February, and that was a great experience for me. Actually, we had the idea to host this in Sölden, and I'm really happy that we had this possibility. We had visitors from France just before the Interalpin. We had visitors from China yesterday, and they are all very enthusiastic about Sölden. So I'm referring to other movie production companies, and they are all thinking of producing movies there now. So even British producers came to see us, and one of the famous British producers said, why don't we have a setting like this, like Sölden? So this is really great for us, especially in terms of rights, and Bond is a very important protected brand mark, and it is known worldwide, so it's very good for our renown. And we managed to prepare everything, to prepare all the buildings, to finish everything on time, even though the weather conditions were very bad for the construction works. And the results are very positive. And in hindsight, I can say, the most difficult tasks you face in your life are probably the ones that can make you very happy. We have gained in international renown thanks to this project. We know that more people come from abroad now. We have improved our image. So Bond is really very important for the success of our resort. So here are a few more pictures. I can only invite you to come and visit us and see for yourselves. So we can show you those Bond images. You can see the road here that was used for the movie. That was the second scene. The first one was the one in the hospital. So we can show you all of that. And that's why it's so authentic. And this spot at an altitude of more than 3,000 meters above sea level is, of course, fantastic. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yes, dear Jack. Stirred or shake is not the question that we will put to you here. The story of Sölden in Ötztal has been a success story for years. Many, many thanks. I'd ask Jack Falkner and Professor Siller to stay around for a short round of Q&A after the next two presentations. It is now a particular pleasure for me to welcome Ursula Weixlbaumer-Norz from Kids and Fun Consulting to our meeting, because she looks after a target group that is extremely important, kids and young people and family. I mean, many people are complaining that young people are not interested in skiing or winter sports anymore, but she has been motivating kids, young people, for many years now to go skiing. We all know when we discuss the next holiday destination as a family that children often say, oh, I don't want to go there anymore. No way I'm going there. And let's see what Ursula has to say about this. Thank you and welcome. Let me put a question to you right now. If we want to know something about the future, who do we ask? Do we ask clairvoyants or shamans, futurologists, or the authors of science fiction novels? Well, I think it would be a good idea, and we would be well advised to ask the kids and young people themselves, because it's them who are going to experience and shape the future. Me and my business often interview kids of all age groups, 6, 8, 10, 12. And last autumn, together with the Institute of Youth Culture Research, we conducted a major study with children aged 10 to 14 on future topics. And let me give you some results. The first question we need to clarify is, What kind of kids am I talking about? Well, we are talking about the Generation Alpha, young people born in 2010 or later. And the Generation Alpha is one of the cohorts, as we call them, that you can see given here. The Generation Alpha is the generation of the future, and that's why I find it so important to ask them directly. Now, the Generation Alpha kids are the kids of the millennials. The millennials were the first digital generation, and these Gen Alpha kids are not only digital themselves, they also have parents who are digital. Now, what are the topics that interest this generation? Climate change, first and foremost. What do I do that affects the environment, and what has this got to do with the future state of the Earth? Digitalization is another important issue for this generation. Artificial intelligence, too, a big issue just now, a hot issue. We're also talking about visuality. TikTok is only the beginning. There will be many more visual media in future. And then we are, of course, talking about virtual reality goggles that are up and coming, and in this context also the metaverse. The metaverse is another big issue that I would like to say a few words about now. What is the metaverse, actually? Now, in simple terms, the metaverse is a virtual reality which exists in parallel to our actual real-life reality. The metaverse is a virtual space that you can enter and experience things there. The metaverse does exist already. The metaverse is reality even now. Mark Zuckerberg, the boss of Facebook or Meta, says he's going to build the metaverse. Well, that's good for him. He will build the metaverse from a business aspect, but as far as entertainment is concerned, the metaverse does already exist. Not in conjunction with VR goggles, but all the games that children play now are metaverse games. Virtual immersive spaces you can enter to experience things. Now let's take a quick look at one of these metaverses. Fortnite specifically, one of the biggest games that are played by the Generation Alpha. Let's take a quick look now. Well, it's not so different, really, from the video by Ed Sheeran we saw just before. Fortnite is a battle royale game with people on a map, that is a virtual island, that shoot each other, and the last person standing wins. There's a lot of entertainment integrated. Fortnite allows you to attend concerts, for example, and there are installations in Fortnite with learning content. Last year, for example, on the occasion of Martin Luther King Day, aspects that offer a learning aspect as well. So it's fun, creates memorable moments for the kids, so it's great entertainment for them, really. Let me mention two terms that will be important for the next part of my presentation. In Fortnite, you move on maps, that's islands, and the avatars that you meet there are called skins. You can buy weapons and also moves in Fortnite, and this is a $1 million business. But why am I telling you all this at this meeting, which is all about mountain tourism? Well, our study showed quite clearly that 84% of male youngsters are gamers. Only, in inverted commas, 46% of the girls play computer games. But I'm not worried. The girls are going to catch up quickly in Asia. There are many games specifically for girls, or both genders. And huge investments are being made. We all know Lego and Epic Games is the company behind Fortnite. These two, together with Sony, are currently investing $2 billion in a metaverse for kids. It's all speculation now when this will be ready, launched in the market. But we need to know that we are facing a new generation of gamers, a generation that will play lots of immersive games in the metaverse. Now, in our research, we also asked the kids about their favorite leisure activities. You can see here that surfing the internet is at the very top of this list. Now, if you try to locate sports in this list, sports come seventh place. Well, we know that during COVID-19, sports lost out extremely. Young girls and boys could not attend their sports clubs. There were no school sports either. So sports is moving down in this ranking all the time. And we need to be careful, because if this development continues, we are not only up against the winter sports problem, but a sports problem in general and overall. So you need to get the kids interested in physicality, in sports and physical games. Now, the real and the virtual worlds and their boundaries are blurring all the time and will continue to blur. We don't necessarily have to take their mobile phones away from our children, but we do need to be careful, especially regarding the contents they are watching. Anyway, there are these real and virtual worlds that are merging, and what we want to achieve is creating real moments as well. Not just virtual moments that we've just seen with Fortnite, but real worlds, real experience. Now, there's good news regarding the real world. Real is in. This might sound strange. There's this new app, Be Real. I don't know if you've got it on your mobile phone already. We've heard this morning about real moments of happiness, resonant moments. And this is something that emotionalizes young people. So you can score with this target group if you create real resonant moments. And another piece of good news, more than 80% of all kids told us in our research that they get along well with their parents. More than 80%. This Generation Alpha is a generation of community. You won't find many rebels there. I mean, getting rid of your parents is no longer a marketing message that appeals to the Generation Alpha. 60 to 70% are still going on holiday with their parents. And that's older teenagers I'm talking about, not because daddy is paying, but they want to experience resonant moments together with their family. They don't see their parents that much because they are working. So in the mountains, when they go to the mountains, they want to experience real life moments. Also, these kids are consumers of leisure time, not designers or shapers of leisure time, because they go to comprehensives and are in school all day. So their daily lives are very much scheduled. And this is what they also expect their holiday to be like. We, as destinations, have to make experiences available to them that the young people can choose from, can actively select. Of course, in the offering we make, we can emphasize emotional or resonant moments to create demand. Another thing that surprised us in our research, 2/3 of the kids told us that COVID-19 was positive for their family. I do not want to play down the big physical and psychological problems that children and young people face during COVID-19, but there seems to be a group, and this group is quite large, that spend all day with their families for the very first time in their lives and who experienced this as very positive. What else happened? Well, they went on holiday during COVID-19, and where did they go? They stayed in Austria, experienced this as very positive, spent a family holiday here. I think these are memorable moments that were created also during COVID-19 that these kids will never forget. So we got many things right during this difficult time. As I said, I don't want to play down the problems with school closures and so on and so forth. I'd just like to mention that there are some positive aspects as well. So the differences, the boundaries between the real and the virtual world will disappear. Kids are looking forward to real life experiences and resonant moments. And whenever we take something from the virtual world and transfer it to the real world, we call it gamification. Now, this is a very important term, gamification, because what is it actually that kids find so great about these computer games? What fascinates them? Well, it's the visuals, it's ideas, it's moments, experiences that are extremely interesting for the kids and that we transfer to the real world. This is not about doing a little gaming or collecting points, awards or scoring. Gamification is much more than this. Has got to do with achievement, with learning, with experience and adventures. A gamification process is something that needs to be initiated and that needs to be managed very carefully. It also needs a good narrative, good storytelling. Now, allow me some self-promotion. We have developed a small and beautiful digital tool to make adventure paths, physical adventure paths, for example, more interesting for kids. A certain degree of gamification of hiking trails, for example. Let me now show you something I find really fascinating, a gamification process, taking something from the virtual world and transferring it to the real world. The video clip I'm going to show you in a moment is a commercial for a detergent. This company really knows their target group. They looked into the language of young people.
They identified kids and young people as a target group. They looked into virtual worlds and tried to transfer some of the elements found there to the real world. It's all based on playing tag with children running one after the other and tagging each other. So the company uses this real life game tag and playing tag as a basis and uses it for their commercial. Let's watch the video now.
This world is not meant for you. Run, boy, run. They're trying to catch you. Run, boy, run. The sun will be guiding you. Run, boy, run. Can time stop you?
Tag, you're it.
Yeah.
Only available in real life, get out and play. I do like that. And I think we can learn from this as tourism destinations. Find out what the young people do and what they want in their own world. If you want to find out more, we are staging a workshop on this topic on the May 5th, physically in Vienna and virtually also. So to use gaming language, let me conclude by saying good luck and have fun, and by thanking you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Our generation is still optimistic that we don't have to fully enter the gaming world because we prefer the real world.
Of today and of the Inspiration Days for INTERALPIN 2023. And it's my great pleasure to welcome from Finland, the whole way down from Finland, and like to welcome here on the stage Mr. Mikko Martikainen and Mr. Kalle Palander. This is the Kalle Palander. The majority of us know definitely as the former ski world champion in Vail in 1997 and winner of many welcome races. And the two gentlemen will tell us about how to make what we have heard in the last 3 days secure also in the future by snow farming, etc. Gentlemen, as usual, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much. A little correction, it was 99, by the way, my world championship gold medal.
Okay, so, meine Damen und Herren, we will speak a practical tool of green transition in a ski resort. So we have developed a tool that's in real life, and we will show it in 10 minutes, roughly. So we start with the video so you can get the video with them.
Hello from Levi. We are here in Lapland, Finland. Amazing skiing already. 7th of October. Wow.
Danke. So when I started to dream about the recycled snow, I was very eager. Because of the snow, I was in Norway, late 70s, we need to have this in Finland. So I started to speak, let's preserve snow, in early 80s, and they said, go to hospital, mental hospital. And it took some while. Year 2000, I made the first in the world for sport. And all the snow storages, in a way, are my babies. Last 5 years, I spent to develop a new system, and as you can see, we can now install 2,000 square meters in 1 hour. So it means 10,000 cubic recycled snow in 1 day. So let's.
So, as Mikko told already, he is a really snow whisperer. He has been in this business for a long time. I'm old former alpine skier, so I started 3 years ago in snow secure, and love for the winter sport, love for the snow, of course. That's my main key. That's why I'm in the business, of course. So the snow farming, there is, of course, in the springtime, you collect the snow, you pile it, you do it nicely. We have many different sizes from 3,000 cubic meters until the 30,000 cubic meters. So we have small farms and the big ones. So in the springtime you collect it, you put it nicely, and then just as you saw in the video, we put the mats over it and cover it. And of course you need to protect it really well, because as you know how windy is it sometimes.
And as you can see, we know this is white. There is energy, there is money. It's a water storage also. And we know the discussion in Austria because of the case of Kitzbühel. So we can have also this green. No problem, problem solved. If you want to have green piles, if you want to have violet, okay. And the next step is, in my mind setting, you can make them landscape art. Not a technical issue, landscape art. People can come and look. This is beautiful, this added something. But we need to start from beginning. So let's skip this, we all have history. So technical side, it's this kind of mat. When you open, you open 72 square meters or 100 square meters. It's waterproof. And also for the wind and for the ultraviolet light.
Yeah, we have actually in the whole W, we have one of the package actually there, so you can see it. How big is it? It 200 kilos is the weight of this. It's 4 meters wide, so you can pack it pretty easily.
Yeah. So. So we have also this multifunction from the beginning. We don't know yet how to utilize them during winter. We have just some ideas. Maybe children area, tunnels, advertising, bar desk, whatever, pop-up bars. Because it was really, really difficult to design for heavy winds, heavy sun load, heavy heat load, rain. So next step is this, and I understand clever clients, clever designers can design something for the winter. Summer insulation, winter something else.
So we have, the levee is the biggest one in Lapland, in Finland, the place where they open always 7th of October. They have 160,000 cubic meters this year already, so they have 10 big storages there. And as you know, we have a World Cup start there also in November, middle of November. And 10 years ago, when we start to work with the chief of Levy, he almost laughed to us that no, we are not going to do snow farming. We buy more snow guns and make the snow that way. Okay, then it was 2 times cancellation for the World Cup opening. I mean, for the World Cup slalom, And then they start to make the snow, and now they have been opening 3 years in a row on 7th of October. And it's a business-wise pretty smart, because they can start to push it already now spring for the kids and for the ski clubs and for the cross-country skiers and for everyone, that they can reserve it already. So they are making really, really good business already at that time, that they can set the date and be sure that they will open it. It doesn't matter if it's plus 10, raining or whatever, they will open the slope. And surprisingly good, this is from the last autumn, 7th of October, I was skiing there whole day. The snow is amazing.
So let's stop a bit here. Of course, we need snow guns. That's so we combine. It's a when you have this snow preservation system in one slope, you don't need so many snow guns. Of course, why do you have a 150% guarantee? 100 is enough. But snowmaking, that's the backbone for the long, long ahead in the future. So here we are above the tree level in Ylläs, very, very windy place, a huge pile. Let's go next. And this is front slopes of Slevi. So if you want to open very early, you need to have quite a lot of snow. But maybe you remember in the video, there was a small pile. That's an utter concept. Because normally, in a ski resort, there's a lot of snow when you end it, right? Why to let the water, the money, flow down? So it's better to have maybe several slopes. You don't need to open them early, but when you start to think, shall we start snowmaking? You take the insulation away and slope open, slope open, slope open. It's very, very fast. And when combining with snowmaking, it's clever.
Yeah, there is actually
there. Okay.
Yeah.
So here, happens, here you can see Levy competition slope. There is no 4-year-old, 3-year-old, 2-year-old, 1-year-old. No one knows exactly how much, and it's perfect.
Yeah, I was there because I worked for the TV as a commentator, alpine skiing expert. So I was there on the slope, and last November when the World Cup was there, so it was no so-called new snow. They didn't make new snow, so it was old snow all the time. And all the racers, as you know, how they are complaining about the snow, that it's too soft or it's too hard or whatever it is. But nobody really realized that it's a so-called old snow. It was even me, who I have been skiing in many, many places, it was so perfect. I was really surprised, actually, that it was so good. The snow quality, I mean.
Yeah. And of course, the main issue behind is saving the water, saving the energy. And how you save the water? When you pile the snow, you don't need to build so many artificial lakes, because this is a water reservoir, much cheaper. And for the snowmaking, you don't need to pump the water, because the water is already in the face of snow. And so the water, and then the energy. So we took the energy because we don't know the prices of water. So snow should be made in cold temperatures here, not here. And normally when you need to start early, the energy consumption can be 10 times more than in cold. But if you have the snow already, you will save a lot of energy. So in Finland, now the energy prices went there, and then they're coming back. But I don't know how it is in Austria or Switzerland. Yeah. But anyway, it can be cheaper to store snow over the summer period than try to make snow in the early season. We have calculations for that. So we save some time. Two methods, two concepts. Guaranteed opening date. Second method, volume. You don't want to open as early as October. Recycle, water saving, energy saving. Yeah, and shortly, that's all. So welcome to visit our stand W24. Thank you.
Thanks. Mikko, Kalle, as we say in Finnish, kiitos for the presentation to save snow and not to produce snow, which is an interesting aspect and also showing how much energy can be saved. Please stay with us for a moment in the front row. Darf ich auf Deutsch wechseln? Sie haben jetzt vier.
Let me switch to German. We have heard four experts speaking on a variety of different topics. Do you have any questions for our speakers? I do assume that you do. Let me just have a look around the audience and see if somebody does want to ask a question, has the courage to ask a question. If this is not the case, I have a question for Jack Falkner, who has to leave us in a moment. This James Bond installation, dear Jack, we know that Sölden is documenting, is keeping records of almost everything. Now, how many new guests or target groups did you attract? I mentioned it in my presentation. It's very international, really, and the number of countries, of nations, is incredibly high. It earned us more international repute and image. And our alliance with our sponsors has also been very fruitful. You can't say it's big business, but it's made us more international, and in economic terms, is working over a 12-year period. Thank you. Excellent. So creativity does pay off. Now, dear Ursula, most marketing efforts are aimed at my generation or those a little younger, but what can we do in order to be attractive for the Generation Alpha? Well, I know from my many years as a consultant that Austria is very good at addressing smaller kids up to 8 years of age. We are not so good in addressing the 8 to 14 years age bracket. So I do recommend that you do some research into this age group, because you can't hand 12-year-olds a mascot. They just are not interested. So do some research into your into this particular target group and take the appropriate action. We don't want to lose these young people. I mean, they don't really know what to do with themselves if we hand out mascots to them or perform a little dancing and try to entertain them in the traditional manner, because you don't want this age group to tell their parents, no, no way I'm going there. So create an attractive offering for the 8 to 14-year age group. Thank you. My next question goes to Hubert. You don't seem to challenge the future of skier days. What is your optimism based on? Well, it's ultimately based on the products and on the solution to the problem, on snow as an asset to create experiences, on the cold season. Snow and everything that goes with it, including skiing, of course, cannot be substituted, cannot be replaced. And there's research that shows quite clearly that the biggest moments of happiness are due to people moving on the snow. So I am absolutely certain and positive that there is a future for winter tourism. And everything to the contrary is not that much fact-based. There is no expiry date for winter tourism, in my opinion. So I'm very optimistic, and I would say that the mountains offer experiences across all generations. Gamification, yes, the leisure behavior, game of young people gaming, 80% of the young people gaming, do pose big challenges, the biggest challenges. Right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm now handing the mic to you, Mikko, as the father of Snow Secure.
Snow Secure. Allow me to.
So, of course, love to snow, as we all have. Very, very eager young boy. So, in last 5 years, the development work was very hard. It was a one-man show, and now we have a partner who owns majority of the shares. It's FinForm, turnover 200 million. So we are not anymore a small company, so we can guarantee some things. And I will retire 1st of July.
Are you allowed to do so?
The young ones will continue. I have done my
work. Are you allowed to do so?
Yeah.
Wonderful. So from inspiration to practice.
Yes.
And together with Kalle, I guess you will be successful in the future. Wie schon angekündigt, fasst der Moderator hier an dieser Stelle nicht zusammen. Er bedankt sich aber an dieser Stelle, dass Sie da waren.
As I said, I'm not going to summarize this event because we have got another person who will do that, who is here live, and that is Markus Linder. Markus Linder, the floor is yours.
Danke, lieber Bruno. Meine Damen und Herren, ladies and gentlemen, Folgendes habe ich herausgefunden.
This summary will not be translated, by the way.
Großen Überblick gegeben über den Alpenbogen, eine kleine Bestandsanalyse. Ja, in den Alpen muss die Freiheit wohl grenzenlos sein. Und alle Sorgen bleiben da oben verborgen, borgen, klein, sicher, kühl und reich. Ja, das ist mir nicht gleich. Und alle singen über den Alpen. Nein, nein. Erfolgslogik. Und das ist schon ein Statement, weil manche Menschen sehen das Wort Erfolg kritisch. Why, please don't be afraid of success. Please don't be afraid of success. Es geht weiter. Convenience war ein wichtiger Begriff. Convenience. Nothing but convenience. Das ist doch der Punkt, um den es sich dreht. Convenience. Nothing but convenience. Ein Gewinner ist, wer das klar versteht. Gestaltung ist Haltung. Das ist ein schönes Wort. Und ich schließe an Udo Jürgens Unterhaltung mit Haltung. Es sang schon DJ Ötzi. Sie ist so schön, sie ist so toll, diese Gestaltung in Tirol. Die Gestaltung zeugt von Haltung, Hubert sagt in der Unterhaltung. Die Natur gibt Stoff für Architektur. Sie ist so schön, DJ Ötzi war nie so intellektuell. Aber intellektuell ist Hans Magnus Enzensberger, der schon Ende der 50er Jahre Dinge über den Tourismus gesagt hat. Ich bin reif, 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 reif für die Insel. Meine Sehnsucht ist groß. Ja, ich bin kein Einfallspinsel. Sand am Strand und Firn oben. oben am Berg. Diese zwei Bilder waren sehr schön. Der Lehnsessel am Strand und die Schneekulisse. Und zum Schluss, es geht um Moments, um Momente, die, denen wir nachjagen. Moment Hunting, Resonanzmomente. Get up, stand up. Stand for Resonanz. Get up, stand up. Momente in Redundanz. Get up, stand up. Stand up for Resonanz. Hunting for those moments. Voll in Redundanz. Ein Applaus für Professor Hubert Siller. Jack Falkner ist leider schon gegangen, hat geredet über die Big Three. The Big Three, three in Sölden. The Big Three with an ägyptische Obelisk on the peak, the Big Three. Dann hat er über die berühmten Restaurants gesprochen. Ice Cube, Ice Cube. Da brauchst keinen Rundflug drum komm, selbst mit Bond daher. Ice Cube, ist keine Fundgrube drum komm, selbst mit Bond daher. Hannibal. Fokat. Karthago bis nach Sölden ist der Elefant gelaufen. Hannibal, Hanni, 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 Hannibal. Und ich weiß jetzt schon, wie Jack Falkner die Produzenten von 007 gewonnen hat. Er ist in London gesessen mit einer Zigarre und hat gesagt, My name's Falkner, Jack Falkner. Und dann hat er gesungen, My name's Jack and I live in the back of the Ötz Valley, please come to Sölden Town. So hat alles funktioniert. Ein Applaus in Abwesenheit für Jack Falkner. Uschi Weixlbaumer-Norz, Kids and Fun. Und das gibt zu denken, diese unterschiedlichen Welten, Realität und virtuelle Realität. Völlig losgelöst vom Realen surft der junge Mensch in der Fiktion. Völlig losgelöst vom Realen surft der junge Mensch in der Fiktionalität. Fiktionalität. Es ist fertig. 80% verstehen sich mit ihren Eltern gut. Das ist doch etwas Positives. Das hätte ich nie gedacht. Vater, Vater, wann fahren wir jetzt den Urlaub zusammen? Mother, Vater, weil wir es zu Hause niemals haben. Father, Mother, wann fahren wir wieder in Urlaub zusammen? Ein Applaus für Uschi Weixlbaumer-Norz, Mikko Martikainen und Kalle Palander. Ich als Skifan bin begeistert. Snow and Secure. Es fährt ein Lift den Berg hinauf. Er fährt nur bei Snow Secure. Auch im Oktober fährt er fix. Ja, das ist für Kalle Freude pur. Es fährt ein Lift den Berg hinauf. Schon bald im Juli geht er schon. Das schon, Schnee wird gelagert und das Wasser muss nicht im See gesammelt werden, sondern ist bereits im Schnee gesammelt. Schnee gelagert. Schnee gelagert. Schneesee, kein Schneesee. Schnee, Schnee gelagert. Und zum Schluss darf ich noch auf eine grundsätzliche Diskussion im Tiroler Tourismus zurückkommen. Während der Pandemie war immer die Frage von Qualitätstourismus, ruhigem Tourismus. Und in Sölden wird Party gefeiert. Das geht beides. Love is in the air, everywhere you look around. Still, still, still. Weil ich meine Ruhe haben will. Hey, hey, baby. Ah, still, still, still. Weil ich endlich meine Ruhe. Love is in the air. Still, everybody knows. Still, let's have a party. Still, still, still. Weil ich nicht mehr weiter reden will.
Lieber Markus, grenzgenial, vielen Dank für deine musikalische Zusammenfassung und auch vielen Dank an Sie, die Sie mit uns.
Thank you, Markus, for this wonderful musical summary. And thank you all for staying to the very end. I wish you pleasant hours at the Interalpin Trade Show. And I will be happy to welcome you back 2 years from now in April or end of May 2025. I would like to warmly thank our speakers of this morning's session. Our event wouldn't have worked without you. I shall be looking forward to seeing you all again. Have a pleasant day and goodbye.